to make a long story short, I counted, and guess how much money was in my freezer. And I was like 22 and a half, 23 years old at this time. I don't know exactly the timeline. I had $1 million.
Oh, my
God. Yes. So here I am, a millionaire.
Oh, my God.
Liquid cash, and I didn't even know it.
You made your first million in your freezer.
You can't make this stuff up.
Oh, my God. Right?
You are watching What's Up Punta Cana with Christy Mayo, una americana italiana en la República Dominicana since 2013. A teacher at heart, but her curiosity has sparked new opportunities. Director, businesswoman, humanitarian, talk show host. La curiosa directora has decided to become the student. Go behind the scenes to get a closer look at what this country is all about. And Cher is here with you. So, if you love everything Dominicana, stay tuned. This is What's Up Punta Cana with Christy Mayo.
So, I am here tonight with Paulie Kazanofski. He is a real estate investor and serial entrepreneur from, Paulie, are you in New York City?
No, Nashville, Tennessee.
Nashville, Tennessee.
That's
why
where
do I feel
reside.
Like you're, you know why?
But I have houses all over the place. So well,
I think
I don't even know where I live anymore, but Nashville is my home.
I think you're in New York City because of all of the New York talk that you guys do
yeah.
on.
Yeah,
on
everybody their... thinks I'm from New York, yeah.
So you sure. are, were you, did you grow up in Tennessee?
No, I grew up in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. And I'm actually originally from Macedonia. It's a former Yugoslavia, and my mom and dad are Macedonian. And then they moved to Canada, and I lived in Canada pretty much my whole adolescence up to 19 years old. So that's where it all started for this young buck.
Wow. Okay. So you were born in Macedonia. How old were you when you went to Canada?
We were 4 years old. I was four.
Wow. So... Yeah. All right, this is going to sound like a crazy question. I guess in Macedonia, they speak Macedonian?
Yes, they speak Macedonian. It's a former Yugoslavia. So there was Serbia, Croatia, Montenegro, Albania, all those countries all in there. They split after communism fell. And so they all took the piece of their little, you know, the little pie there you call a country. And now it's all mixed, you know?
Yes.
But we were all former Yugoslavia. It was a bigger country back then, many, many years ago when communism existed.
Wow. See, I'm really excited to have you here with me. For the listeners that are just tuning in now, I am here with Paulie Kazanofski. Kazanofski, am I pronouncing it right?
Yeah, you okay. said it perfect. It's almost like you know what you're talking about there when you...
Maybe a little bit. I'm pretty good at pretending. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
So I know you through the different, coaching sessions. And so, but I don't want to get into that yet. I want, you know, I'm very intrigued by you. You are a real estate investor. You are a serial yes. entrepreneur. You're pretty high up there. And I need to know your story because that is every week when I watch or when I listen or you guys go live, I'm like, what's his story? What is his story?
Yes.
So tell me about your childhood in Canada
yes.
and when did you come to the United States?
Well, we came here when I was four and we moved to Montreal. My mom and dad ended up escaping communism through Greece.
Wow.
And then they went to Canada and they got there and we lived in a really, really bad neighborhood because, you know, they were immigrants. We were immigrants. We didn't have the language. We didn't have clothes. We didn't know the culture, you know? And my mom and dad ended up getting a divorce there a year after. And so I didn't know my dad for many, many years until I was around 20 when I re-met him. But my mom was a single mom. We lived in a place called Point St. Charles, which was settled by the Irish in the famine. And the, you know, it was kind of mixed cultures, but it was predominantly Irish. And then it was a really lower class area, blue collar, kind of like a ghetto, without the guns in a sense, you know, very, poverty stricken, a lot of alcohol, drugs, things like that. And when I was a kid, you know, I didn't have hope, you know, as I grew to 7, 8, 9, I just knew what I knew, you know, and my mom coming from communism, she, you know, they were poor even back in Macedonia, but when they came to Canada, they lived the same way. Their scarcity mindset was still an abundance in her mind. And for me, growing up in Canada, I had to learn how to speak French first because it's predominantly French. And there was a lot of Haitians in my area. So that's kind of the start of it. And then one day I was getting picked on by these three brothers that lived in across the alley from my home where we lived in the projects. It was like government housing, and it was a pretty rough little backyard area and alley area. So a lot of fights happened there. And one day my mom saw me in a fight and she got mad because she was seeing that all these kids were picking on me because I was the immigrant kid, you know, the little skinny immigrant kid. And she and I came up crying like a big baby, and she brought me to the local gym, and the gym was called Shamrock Boxing Gym, and that gym had a family called the Hilton Brothers and the Hiltons. And Davey Sr. was the gym coordinator there. He kind of ran the gym. He was the gym manager. And I found my passion that day when my mom brought me there, and she kind of explained to them, look, you know, I don't have a husband. I'm a single mom, and this kid's getting picked on, and, you know, he's a little skinny kid, we're immigrants, we don't know the language, things like that. So, you know, he said, look, I got you, ma'am. And my mom was very friendly, but she talked with broken English, and so everybody loved her because she always said Miss Thank You to everybody, you know. So they started calling her Mrs. Thank You.
Aww.
And from there go ahead. Sorry.
No, I do. I want, that's so sweet. I want to stop you there because I have a couple questions.
Yeah.
First. So you said that your parents had escaped from,
they escaped from Yugoslavia through Greece.
So
they escaped communism through Greece with us, and then they went to Canada. And that's how we ended up in Canada. And then thereafter, about less than a year, my mom and dad got a divorce. I don't know the strains of being poor, not knowing the language. I don't know exactly
right. What
happened.
But my question is, I want to go back there, back to Yugoslavia. So they had you. Did you have brothers and sisters?
Yeah, I have an older sister. Yeah, my sister's a year and a half older than me.
So what do you know what they had to do to escape? Like, was it a train? Did they have to walk?
They went through hell. I mean, they went through hell and, you know, and had to sleep on the streets. And we did, too. I remember it. I mean, I have a really good memory. I had to sleep on the streets to get there. And then we somehow, some way, I don't know exactly all the details, but we ended up coming to Canada. And I guess my dad's father was in Canada first, my grandfather.
Oh.
And he had a house. Yeah, he had a house. That's how they were able to come. And they ended up living in a place, you know, like I mentioned, Point St. Charles on Knox, Knox Street. And so he had like this little kind of rundown house, and we lived there. And then, you know, when they got a divorce, my mom ended up getting that government housing. And we ended up going with my mom, and my dad ended up moving to Ontario, and I didn't see him for, you know, probably 15 years, somewhere around there.
I understand. So when you got there, so you spoke Macedonian, and then you had to learn French, correct?
Yeah, because when you come to Canada, mm-hmm. in the Montreal area, specifically in the Montreal area, you kind of have to learn French because there's a lot of French-speaking people. Obviously, it's Quebec. It's a predominantly French-spoken place, but everybody's bilingual. Everybody speaks English, too. But the primary language in Montreal is French, so we had to learn French, and then I learned English. So English is actually my third language, obviously.
Wow.
And it was a ride, and you know, and obviously, you know, when you're a kid, you could pick up English and French rather quickly.
Yes.
And that's what I did. You know, I picked it up and hanging out in the streets, and you know, like when I was young, my mom was really strict on me and stuff like that. She wanted the best for us in mm-hmm. the situation that we were in. And like, people hung out on the corners. There was a lot of, you know, drugs and alcohol. It was a tough place.
Yeah.
Point St. Charles is a rough place. You know, if you don't live there and you come there, especially when I was going there, you would get robbed. You would get your shoes robbed, your money robbed, like if they didn't know who you were. So it wasn't the prettiest place to grow up, but having my mom the way she was strict, and she got us involved with, you know, things like sports and arts and playing. I played drums, you know, I was into music and, you know, my mom, even though I was not good in school because I'm dyslexic and I can't read that well and, you know, and things just didn't come easy for me in school, I still did activities. And, you know, with the boxing, when I found boxing, I found my passion. I found something that gave me the discipline and really the hope of becoming something out of nothing, out of the area that we lived in. And
wow.
With that, it made me dream. And because, look, growing up the way I did, it's like a concentration camp without the barbed wire where mm-hmm. I grew up. It, you know, people are born there, they live there, they die there. They don't get out of those neighborhoods. Those poverty-stricken neighborhoods, people don't get out of it. It's kind of like Brooklyn, Bronx, you know, back east. It was very, very New York style,
right.
But in Montreal, you know, just you could imagine how it was in a sense, you know. So
for sure.
That's why everybody thinks I'm from New York, because that's kind of the way my neighborhood was.
Mm-hmm. Well, then it's all the joking around that you guys do so, and you actually do have that accent, so it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
So you found boxing. And
yeah.
So what did that do for you? Like, how old were you when you started? And
I was eight and a half. I was a little 60-pound kid, you know, and I just found something that, you know, changed my life, really. And, you know, I was always a good little athlete, you know, fast and wiry, and I could do gymnastics. And, you know, being from Yugoslavia, that was like, you know, athletics were something the communists did a lot, you know.
Right.
Like, if you look at Romania or Russia, you know, all those communist countries at the time, they were really good at sports. So
mm-hmm.
my mom came from that cloth. She was cut from that cloth. So she put us in gymnastics and drama and theater and all this stuff. So I was pretty good at a lot of things, but I couldn't defend myself because there was a lot of, like, brothers or people would gang up on you. There would be, it's never a one-on-one fight in
right.
my neighborhood, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so my mom got fed up, and that's why she brought me to the gym. And when I got to the gym, I found my confidence. I found how to fight. I found how I could defend myself. I started building my body. I became a strong, strong, young guy, you know, shredded and ripped, and I could fight. I learned how to fight in the gym, and I got my respect in the gym. And I also found my discipline. I found my way to stay off the streets and not get involved with, you know, a certain gang in the neighborhood at a young age and,
mm-hmm.
and things like that. Now, granted, I will admit, you know, as I got older, you know, like when you live there, you succumb to some of the stuff. So I did hang with some bad folks in my town and, you know, and I started doing some things I'm not proud of. But, you know, when you're hungry and your mom has no money and, you know, my mom used to clean people's houses and they would treat her bad and she'd come home and cry. And I saw that and it would get me mad. And, you know, as I got older, 13, 14, 15, I wanted to provide. I wanted, because I was the man of the house. So I went and I did some things I'm not proud of. You know, I got involved with some of the kind of the kind of little gangs. But I never really did do anything like I never drank. I never did drugs. I never smoked because my mom just was so on me. Like, don't ever do that. She would say, weak people do that. If you do that, weak people do it. And, you know, look, some of the people that get hooked on that, it doesn't mean they're 100% weak. It's just they started small, right, and it got bigger and bigger. I just never did. Even though I did some things, you know, I used to get in a lot of street fights and, you know, people would try to rob my jacket or something and I would fight them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They would try to rob my money and I would fight them. And I became a tough kid in my neighborhood. And then I was a highly decorated boxer as an amateur. And people started knowing who I was as I got into my 15, 16, 17-year-old days, you know.
Wow.
So, you know, I went from being the kid that was young and skinny and all that to a pretty tough kid that would fight anybody at a drop of a dime, because that was survival in my neighborhood, you know. And like my mom and I, we couldn't see eye to eye as I got older, because she looked at me as a bad kid, even though I didn't succumb to those things. She did kind of look at me as that kind of like a bad kid, because mm-hmm. in her country, you should be in a box and you should do everything perfect. And I didn't like school because I was dyslexic. And so all those things kind of came to a halt. And I left my house at 15 and a half years old. So I've been on my own since I was 15 and a half.
Wow. Where did, okay. Yeah. So, and just a side note there, I used to play the drums too.
Yeah, fantastic. I played the drums for many, many, many years. I still practice, and I have a pair of drums in my house. And I practice all the time.
I wish I could say I did, but I don't.
I played in bands and everything. I just love it.
Nice.
Very physical.
Yes,
physical instrument.
Okay, so you left home at 15 and a half. Where
yeah.
did you go, and what did you do?
Well, you know, I stayed with some friends. Their mom and dad took me in because my mom just was, she just, every time I got into trouble at school or I did something she didn't agree with, she would just throw me out of the house. And that's how they did it in Europe. They were really tough on their kids, and I just couldn't see eye to eye. Here I am, a kid growing up in the American and Canadian culture, mm-hmm. and I'm stuck in, you know, former communism with my mom. And I understood why she does it now, but as a 15-year-old kid, you don't understand it.
Right.
So I was just like, I can't deal with this. And, you know, the negativity and the name-calling and the beatings I used to get. So, you know, that's how they raise their kids. You know, it's not because she meant it. And
right.
I'm not mad at her. I love her still. I take care of her still. But it's just the way it was back
right.
then, you know. Like, there was no book how you raise your kid. And my mom was more into that kind of iron fist, rule the house with iron fist.
Mm-hmm.
And here I am growing up in this neighborhood, in this culture of an American, North American culture. And so I just wanted to live my life. I wanted to be something. My mom used to say, that's for the rich people. Don't talk like that. You know what? Just go to school and get a job. You need to study. You're stupid and all that stuff. And and I was like, Ma, I don't learn like the other kids. I'm just like, I don't know how to read that the way they do. I don't comprehend the way they do. Even though all the teachers said, man, he's an intelligent, bright guy. Everybody loves him. He's got personality. He's energetic. He's smart at other things, but just this reading thing is not. And back then, you know, I'm 53. I mean, back then,
right?
You know, they didn't really know how to analyze and help someone
right.
that had dyslexia and all these learning things.
Right.
And for me, I just felt like, hey, man, I don't fit here. But I knew I was going to do something with my life. I thought I was going to be a champion boxer or a drummer in a band or an actor or something. I was going to make it out of my neighborhood. I was not going to stay there ever. I wasn't going to stay there ever. As soon as I knew that I was old enough and I had a way to get out of there, I was going to get out of there. And that's why I think I kept myself away from, like, the drugs and the alcohol and all that. When, you know, sad to say, but a lot of my friends that I grew up and my gang that I was in, they succumbed to those type of things. And they graduated from doing petty theft to grand theft to starting to do armed robberies to bank robberies. And, you know, that's not where I wanted to be. I didn't want to be them. And so I stayed very vigilant with my boxing and my drumming. And I said, one day I'm just going to leave. I'm just going to leave. And when 19 years came, I went to meet my aunt and uncle for the first time on my father's side, because we lost contact with my father's side of the family. His sister lived in California, and I went to a wedding and I met them. And we hit it off, and it was my aunt and uncle that I didn't know since the age of 4 years old. So they said, come and visit us. Come and see California. And when I did, I saw how they lived, and they were in real estate. That's what they did. They were real estate people.
Wow.
And for the first time, I saw how rich people live, and they had food in their fridge, and they had cars. We never had a car. I never had a pizza at my house. We didn't get ice cream and all this. And here I'm like looking at these people, my aunt and uncle, and they're living the way they did in California. Beautiful. So I when I went home, I decided I'm leaving and I'm coming to America illegally. We went to Canada illegally. I might as well come to America legally. And I did. And I bought a two-way ticket. I sold very little that I had. And I had a couple of $1,000s in my pocket. I knew how to hustle. I knew, because when I was 13, 14, 15, 16, I used to scalp tickets. I used to sell tickets at the Montreal Forum for advanced hockey games, concerts and things. So I knew how to make money. No matter where you drop me, I could make money. Any country, any place, I know how to make money. But I wasn't a businessman. I just knew how to survive. I knew how, if I had to steal something and sell it and make money so I could survive, I knew how to do that. And when I came to California, even though I didn't know anybody except for my aunt and uncle, I didn't want to be a burden on them.
Mm-hmm.
So I came and I started scalping tickets. I started buying cars and fixing them up and selling them. I bought furniture. I was buying furniture out of a thing, a little newspaper back then called The Recycler. And I would buy and negotiate people low. And then I would sell it back in the same newspaper and I'd double my money. So I did that for about 6 months. And then I got an opportunity to sell for this guy that met me while I was selling a car that I bought and I resold. I flipped the car, so to speak. And he said, man, I know a guy that would hire you in a heartbeat. And I said, nobody will hire me because I don't have my papers. I'm illegal here. And he said, it doesn't matter. They make money. They make cash money. And so I went and I had an interview with the guy. He loved my personality and my energy. And I kind of told him my history a little bit. And he goes, I think you're going to be really good. Tomorrow you come in and I'll put you with my top sales guys and I'll teach you how to do this business. And it was in the audio business, and they would sell speakers out of a van. They sold audio visual speakers and home theater surround sounds out of a van. And so I started doing that, and it was kind of like a hustle. You know, we would tell people, oh, we got overloaded, but it was legal, but it was a hustle pitch. And I learned how to sell something to somebody who wasn't expecting to buy that day. And it was kind of a high pressure sale. And I wasn't in love with the job, but what I did. Saved my money. I then had the opportunity to buy this young guy that was running the company out, because him and his wife were getting a divorce and he had to move back to Jersey. And when he went back to Jersey, I bought the business because I saved my money. All the other sales guys, they were drinking and chasing women and mm-hmm. going to clubs and all that. And me, I was at the boxing gym because that's why I came to America. I thought I was going to be a world champion boxer, right? So right. that's what I was trying to do, but I still had to work. I had to feed myself. And so I saved my money and I played drums, I boxed, and I did this business. And that business started taking off, and I started learning about business. And then I found my passion, so I started reading self-help books, and I started listening to tapes, people like Earl Nightingale mm. and Jim Rohn, and they were talking to me. Those guys gave me the hope that I needed as a young guy, and the hope that I never had as a kid in that neighborhood I grew up. And so I started learning on how people think and how to motivate people and how to talk better. Because look, right now I'm talking to you and you hear the way I talk. I was a street kid. I didn't always talk, you know, and I wasn't always like a nice guy. Like, you know, I did some things. I used to collect money for certain people, you know, back in my neighborhood when I was like 17, 18, 19 years old mm-hmm. before I left. And I knew I had to get out of there or else I would end up like a lot of my friends were. And that was my motivation. That was my motivation, you know?
Wow. Like this, your story is like 10 times more than I thought it was. And like, that's
and
really
by the way,
incredible.
It's verifiable.
No.
Everything I just said.
I believe everything that you just said.
I promise you.
You can't even know. You can't even describe something like that in such detail. But you know what? It's one of those things that for me, that gives me hope for a lot of these young kids out there today. Because you know, there's so many stories with young people like yours in that sense that, you know, do overcome, that do it. But you have that desire. You have that internal drive. And you have the motivation to want more. And you have that one little taste. And then you have the discipline to back it up, right? So.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean.
And, you know, to be honest, like, you learn how to be better. And I never had a mentor when I was a kid. You know, of course, my boxing coach and all that. And, you know, I had some other coaches mm-hmm. that kind of gave you the discipline and a blueprint. But, you know, when you grow up the way I did, there was no real, like, no one really to look up to except mm-hmm. for, like, athletes or, you know, certain boxers for me because I love boxing. But when I saw my aunt and uncle, and they were just average, regular people that came from former Yugoslavia. And mm-hmm. I saw that you could prosper. I knew that business was my route, too. Now, granted, I still was trying to be a world champion boxer. I signed a pro contract. I did all of that. And
right.
I played in bands. And I thought, either I'm going to do a boxing or I'm going to make it in music. But I'm going to make it in something.
Right.
I just didn't know I was going to make it in business because I didn't think that way at that time until I started making money doing, you know, obviously I was making money flipping cars, doing the furniture and buying certain things and flipping it and making money, hustling at the forum, doing events, you know, with tickets. But when I found the sales thing, and I became the top sales guy. And then I saved my money and I bought the guy out when he was getting a divorce and he moved to Jersey. I started with one office and I was making so much money and it was all cash. And here's the problem that most people don't know. I couldn't put it in a bank. I wasn't legally in America. I didn't have papers. I came here illegally. I had to survive. So here I'm as a young guy, I'm like 19 years old and I'm no BS. I was making about $15,000 to $20,000 a month to start in one office. Then my office, I grew the office when I bought it. I made it better. because the guy who ran it was a good guy, but he didn't have the motivation that I had. He didn't have the upbringing mm-hmm. that I had. He didn't have the scarcity that I had. So for me, I just wanted to be something. I wanted respect for myself. I found something that can get me to be rich, because when I was young, I just wanted to be rich. I thought about, man, wouldn't it be nice to have big houses mm-hmm. like what I saw my aunt and uncle had and things like that. So my motivation level, all I did was work and go to the gym. I did those two things. I slept 4 or 5 hours a night. That's it. And I just worked. And then I went to the gym, and my insatiable energy was so intense. And, you know, I was in really good shape. I mean, like, I ate well. I juiced. I'm one of those, like, really healthy, health freaks. Uh-huh. And so, you know, I knew I was going to make it. And here I'm making all this money. I didn't know what to do with the money, so I put it in my freezer. No BS. I put it in my freezer. Christy, you got to believe
me. That's so Italian.
I put all my money, and I wrapped it up in, like, foil to make it look like me, because when I was gone, I thought, man, if anybody ever knew, what are they going to think? I got all this money, and I didn't know how much money I had. Well, several years later, fast forward, we started other offices. We grew the company. Me and a sales manager that happened to be one of my friends that I met in America. And so I grew this thing really big. And one Saturday, I got up and I was in a panic, and people don't, you know, you got to understand, I'm illegally in a place in America. I have no papers. I can't put my money in the bank. I'm making money with this business, the speaker business, and I'm growing this thing. Somehow I had a talent for selling and a talent for motivating my salespeople. And then I would teach them and empower them to be better sales guys. And I would do motivational speeches to them, and then I'd send them out to go sell. I would give them bonuses if they did well. If they didn't do well, I would encourage them and make them know that they're not bad. They just need to, you know, analyze how they're doing their pitch and what they're saying while they're doing their sale. And then I would help them. I would encourage them to be better the next day. Mm-hmm. And to make a long story short, that Saturday, those Saturday I was telling you about, I said, I'm going to count the money I have. I don't know what came into my head, but I didn't know exactly how much money I had in my fridge. I thought it was around $400,000 or
$500,000. What did you have?
That's about what it was. I didn't know, because I would just tinfoil it and put it away. Again, I didn't do drugs. I didn't chase women. I didn't go to clubs. I didn't have time to do any of that when I was a kid. I was working and in the gym, playing my drums in the gyms, working. That's all I ever did. And then one Saturday, I started counting my money. And lo and behold, and of course, I had to thaw it out. Because, yes, anybody wondering, does money freeze? Yes, it freezes. And I had to thaw it out. So I was in my house thawing out this money, right? On my bed, on my carpet, everywhere, because it had to, you know, because it froze like almost like a brick in a way. And you guys could try it. Anybody listening, you could try it. You'll see what I mean. I know. I have experience with this. So now I have to thaw out all this money. And I start, as it thaws out later on that afternoon, I start counting the money and counting the money and counting the money and counting the money.
How many
right?
hours?
And I get to... What's that?
How many hours did it take?
Well, with the thawing out and doing everything, it was about 8 hours. With counting it, thawing it out, and the money was still a little wet when I was counting it. But I counted it, and I said, if anybody ever comes in my house right now, they would think I'm counterfeiting or something, or I'm a drug dealer or something. But I couldn't put my money in the bank. So my bank was the freezer, the bank of freezer. So I start counting it. Nobody knew. There was only one guy that I knew. His name was Bernie Gallarani. He's a good friend of mine still to this day. He's the only one that knew that I put my money in my freezer, right? And so anyway, I counted it out. I got to 500,000, and I started to panic. I had a panic attack for the first time in my life. I was like, holy crap, what am I going to do? How am I gonna, like, no one would believe me if I told them this story. Like, I didn't know what to do with them. And I never spent money. I was always working or at the gym. Like, you don't spend a lot of money. You spend money on gas and whatever in your apartment. At the time, I couldn't buy a house, right? Because I didn't have no papers. You can't buy a house and so on and so forth. Unless it was for cash, which I later on did. But to make a long story short, I counted and guess how much money was in my freezer. And I was like 22 and a half, 23 years old at this time. I don't know exactly the timeline. I had $1 million.
Oh my
God. Yes. So here I am, a millionaire.
Oh my God.
Liquid cash. And I didn't even know it.
You made your first million in your freezer.
You can't make this stuff up.
Oh my God.
Right? And so I count the money. Now you think I'm a wreck. I'm a wreck. You would think I'm happy, right? No. I am so panic stricken because I'm like, what in the world am I going to do? Who
right.
do I talk to? Do I call my aunt and uncle? They're going to think there's no way this kid made this much money. He must be doing something. He came from the hood. He was like a street kid. He must have did something. So I didn't want to call them and worry them. So I had a girlfriend at the time. And so I said, well, maybe I should tell her because what am I like? I don't know. I felt alone.
You told a girl
in America.
You don't tell a girl you have $1 million in your freezer.
So, well, that night, it's about 12 at night, Saturday going into Sunday morning. I call my girlfriend and I said, you have to come over. And she goes, right now it's late. I said, no, tomorrow, whenever. I have to talk to you. She thought I was breaking up with her. I said, no, I'm not breaking up with you. It's a serious conversation we have to have. And she came over to my house and I told her and she thought I was lying to her. She goes, no way. And I said, yes way. And I showed it to her and she about like freaked out. And she's like, what are you going to do? And I said, I don't know. And then I devised a plan on how to filter it through. And so we ended up talking to her mom, who I was very close with. By the way, the story gets good. I ended up marrying the girl.
Oh, well, that's good because I'm over here. I'm like, oh my God, please don't tell me that like she robbed you.
No,
thank the good Lord. You got married.
No, she wouldn't do that. No, I wouldn't tell her if I thought like, look, I'm a type of guy. I like when I date a girl, it's like, even when I was growing up as a young kid in my neighborhood, mm-hmm. I dated the smart girl, the kind of like girl that didn't involve herself with like the back. Like, I always liked a kind of a feminine type girl that was like soft and nurturing. So she was like that, you know, and my wife is amazing. She's like that too. And like, that's who I typically date girls that are very highly educated, mm-hmm. unlike myself.
Well, that's good. That's good. Okay, so I have like 2 minutes, so we have to like fast forward. Okay, so how did you get to where, I mean, obviously you got to where you are. When did you meet Mr. Fox, and how'd you get into that?
If you fast forward the story, of course I filtered that money. I bought a house for cash. Mm-hmm. And we bought it through my mother-in-law's name, you know, my wife and my mother-in-law's name. We filtered the money through. I bought a house in Las Vegas. I had an office out there. So I ended up going to Las Vegas. And then I built a custom home for us. And then I ended up selling that custom home. And that's how I got into real estate, by accident. Mm. Because I hired a contractor to build my home, that is custom, beautiful home with the waterfall edge, pool, and the whole nine yards. And I was paying him cash. When they did the foundation, paid him cash, framing all of it, the pool, and so on and so forth, right? So a couple from California drove by one day and said, hey, is your father here? And I'm like, what do you mean? I was there just kind of doing the last minute touch-ups and spraying like in the front in the lawn and stuff like that, just making sure the plants and everything were clean. And they came up to me, thought like it was my dad's house. I'm like, no, actually, this is my house. They're like, what? Because I looked young. I still look young, but right. I looked really young then. And so I'm like, no, this is my house. I just built it for cash. They're like, what? I'm like, yes. So they said, well, my wife loves this house. I'm like, come on in. I'll let you see it. So I walked them around. They when we finished the tour, she and he looked at me and said, man, we would like to buy this. And I said, everything's for sale. And they're like, you just told me that this was your dream house that you built for you and your girlfriend, because she was still my girlfriend at the time. Mm-hmm. And I said, yeah, but everything's for sale. Make me an offer. And I ended up selling them the house, making $88,000 in net profit after paying everything. So that's why I got into real estate.
Wow.
So I started doing real estate 2008. It kind of was like a crash. In 2007, it started dissipating. So I was building custom homes with this guy, and I was providing him the cash. We were building them. We were selling them. We were splitting the profit. I was still doing the speaker business. I was boxing still. I was still doing the boxing almost like a full-time thing too, right?
Right.
Then the market crashed in 2007 and mm-hmm. 2008. It started dissipating. I moved to Nashville, where I am today.
Right.
I bought a house and a bunch of rental properties. I left Nevada with millions of dollars. So I
wow.
came here. I bought a house on a lake for cash, and I fixed it up even nicer than it was. I bought rental properties for cash and so on. But I started flipping houses because in the crash, you couldn't build and make money. It wasn't advantageous to do
right.
that. So I got into flipping houses, and there and below, I go to a seminar to learn better techniques, better strategies. And that's the first time I saw J.T. Fox. This was around 10 years ago. And he picked me out of the crowd because he saw my energy and how I was. And I was mm-hmm. very helpful to other people. And he goes, there's a guy in this room. I think he's got something special, whatever. He brings me up on stage.
Wow.
He calls my wife, literally calls my wife. He does one of his, you know, his coaching right in front mm-hmm. of everybody, trying to embarrass me. You know what I mean? And so he called my wife and said, what do you think is holding your husband from being worth $10 million plus dollars? And he thought she was going to throw me under the bus, but she didn't. She said, he's too good of a guy. His heart is too good. He came from nothing. He built a business, and that's what's holding him back, because he's too good. He's too loyal. He's too character. He'll take the hit before he causes somebody to lose money. And I think that's what's holding him back. But other than that, he's like the greatest guy, and I'm wow. glad he's my husband. And the whole crowd couldn't believe it, because typically when you ask a wife to a husband, the wife's going to make the husband seem like a bad guy. So he realized right there, man, if your wife talked that way about you, you must be a good guy. And he looked at me and he said, one day you're going to have a show on TV. One day you're going to be a speaker. One day you're going to be a motivator. One day you're going to take my place as a speaker. And he goes, I want to coach you. And I signed up for coaching. And then I stayed loyal to him mm-hmm. for literally almost 10 years now. And I built my business alongside with him, mentoring me, coaching me, and sometimes telling me things that I didn't want to hear, and
wow.
being tough on me, because that's what a good coach does. When I was mm-hmm. a boxer and a kickboxer, my coaches were mean and rough and tough, and I didn't mind it. I was used to it from growing up with my mom and
right.
her communist ways and the iron fist ruling. So I was okay with having a tough coach. And
right.
JT was tough, but he also loved.
Right.
And he made sure that I would grow and I would be a part of his organization.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, now I do business with him. He's lent me so much money to do deals. As a matter of fact, as we speak, I have over $10 million of his money doing deals together. And imagine a kid that grew up with
right.
the story I just told you. And now I'm doing business with these like nine-figure guys And it's just been a pleasure and just amazing to be able to grow and be able to help people. I coach people now.
Yeah.
I coach them on how to do real estate and strategies. And, you know, I get more of fulfillment from watching other people succeed because I have everything I ever wanted. I got it very young, as a matter of fact.
Right.
Remember my story. I was a millionaire at 22.
Right.
You know what I mean?
That's right.
22, you know, 23, I was like counting out liquid cash. And I don't spend my money. I don't live lavishly. I don't buy Ferraris and stuff like that. I don't care about stuff like that. I care about houses, real estate, growing my money, putting my money into something that, that kind of grows and spits out cash flow. That's what I love.
Paulie,
and I live off the cash flow.
You're absolutely amazing. I have like 10 times, like I already had respect for you, but like absolutely amazing story. I'm being cut off over here, but at the same time, like you are an inspiration. You created you, you know, you are the one that drove you, you know, everything else came after, but you created your first million and you did that all on your own. And like, for me, that is just absolutely incredible, and you truly are an inspiration, and I thank you so, so very much for sharing your story with me today, because it's just, I love it. I do. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks to anybody listening, and anybody can have hope. It doesn't matter where you're from, who your parents were. Doesn't matter anybody that says you can't do it. You hear it from Uncle Paulie. This guy right here, he did it. And a lot of people doubted me. And a lot of people saw my special gift.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? And a lot of people encouraged me along the way. But I really appreciate you.
Thank you, Paulie.
I thank you for having me on your show.
Thank you. We're here with Paulie Kazanofski. And I really look forward to, you know, continuing this relationship and continuing to learn more about you. And thank you so much for being on my show, What's Up Punta Cana, tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you.